Jeff Manchester, Manchester Music. We're going to leave the door open this time so I don't turn into a sweaty puddle of man cheese. I did a video a couple days ago, and it was about PMC monitors, and I reviewed their Result 6s. Phenomenal speakers. Phenomenal. When I did that video, in the title, I wrote like a very clickbaity title, albeit it was like, you know, the best intro monitor for composers, and I wasn't kidding. It really was something that I was wondering when I was testing them out. But a very clever user commented, I don't know why I called him a user, or him, it could be it, could be a dog, said, "I'm surprised that you would say that this is like an intro level speaker, because I looked at the price point and oh my God, that is not what I consider to be like intro level, you know, monitor. Do you have any recommendations for things under," and then he said a certain price point. It just made me think of all the ways in our lives that we kind of place value on things based on price and need and want. For example, you might splurge on your computer. You want something that's super future-proofed, right? You want something that's going to last you a long time, plenty of RAM, plenty of hardware, plenty of, I don't know, the processor's amazing and everything, just so it lasts you for a long time. But when it comes to a MIDI keyboard, maybe you'll be like, I'll just get a little piece of plastic, doesn't really matter. I don't need a screen or a bunch of buttons or pads or faders. I just need like the bare minimum to feel creative. We make these trade-offs all the time. And what I want to talk to you about is why I think you should not make trade-offs or any compromises when it comes to studio monitors. And I want to be careful because I know that not everyone can come up with like a business case to support buying super expensive studio monitors, but they're very important. And I think that the more time I've spent going to trade shows, learning from people in broadcast, in post, in music, all over the place, the more I've just really learned to appreciate a good sounding studio monitor. And I've developed what I think is a pretty good metaphor to explain the difference between your budget intro speakers, monitors, and your, you know, high-end, more, you know, kind of analytical studio monitors. And it goes something like this. It's like the difference between carpet and hardwood floors. It's weird to say hardwood because you say hardwood, but I'm like hardwood. When you're walking on carpet, it's a very pleasant experience. It's a great experience. It's plush. You feel supported. You feel kind of cushioned. If there's stuff in the carpet, especially if it's a nice thick carpet, the kind that I used to see when I went to Catholic Mass, it's like this thick. You might not see stuff in the carpet, especially from far away. There might be stuff hiding in the carpet, but you don't really notice it because you just can't really see it. It's kind of absorbed in the fibers and everything. If you're walking on a really thick, plush, cushy carpet, there might be stuff hitting your feet, but you don't really feel it because it's been kind of masked by other stuff or just fibers or whatever. You'll feel like a bump of it or something, but it's not a big deal. It's an overall pleasant walking experience, and that's how it's designed. It's meant to make you feel nice and warm when you get out of bed. It's really cold. You put your feet on the carpet. It's just a great experience overall. Whereas hardwood is more expensive than carpet. It's more complicated to lay down. You got to rip out the old stuff, put the new stuff in. I say that like I've never done an honest day's work in my life with these hands, but I assume that laying down hardwood is kind of a hard thing to do. But once you do it, hardwood is objective. You can see things, you know, meters ahead of you, or feet or inches for my American people. You can see stuff well ahead of you that you couldn't really see with carpet. Everything's kind of exposed. If you walk on something, there's nothing to mask the feeling of that. You'll feel, a toenail. You'll feel a piece of stale food. It'll crunch on your foot. You'll be like, oh my God. Even sometimes walking, the act of walking on hardwood will reveal things, if you're used to carpet, about your own body and legs and feet. And you're like, oh my God, my feet are sore. Like I have bad muscle tone. Or anyway, it's just an extremely revealing surface that's more expensive, but more honest in its representation of what walking feels like and what's in your area. And that to me is kind of the way studio monitors are when you go from budget to high end. When you're dealing with a carpet speaker, and I don't want to talk about brands or price points or anything, but let's just say you know what the budget speakers are out there, okay? You're dealing with carpet. You're dealing with something that's designed to give you a pleasant experience, designed to mask stuff, accentuate stuff, maybe low end. Maybe the low end is so accentuated that you don't notice that when you bring it to your hardwood speakers, there's sibilance. There's stuff inside the mix, objectively, that's just kind of there, and you don't hear it because you're dealing with a system that is designed to give you a very pleasant, entertaining experience. Bose, Beats by Dre, now I'm naming brands. These kind of things are designed for leisure, for walking around on carpet and feeling great. Whereas when you deal with a higher end speaker, like the kind that I'm reviewing and talking about in the videos, I don't want to make this all about me. We're dealing with hardwood floors. Nothing is masked. In fact, so much research and technology goes into making sure that nothing gets lost in the little bits and fibers of the carpet speakers. Everything is revealed. So you'll hear sibilance that might have been masked by the fibers of the carpet in the low end that was accentuated in those carpet speakers. Now, when you bring it to your hardwood speakers, everything is way more apparent to you and objective. Everything is kind of revealed. That is what you are paying for when you are paying for higher end monitors. And I think it's application agnostic. You could be working on mastering stuff, composing, you could be doing mixing, you could be doing beat making, whatever. Having an objective, neutral source to make decisions about what needs to be added, changed, colored, decolored, whatever, is so important. And that's what you are paying for when you are paying for a higher end hardwood monitor system. And that's, to me, is like the best metaphor that I could think of for the kind of truth about, you know, about speaker systems. We are dealing, I think, as composers, music makers, with analytical music creation. That is why I am trying to make the case that as a composer, as a music maker, you should really think of higher-end monitors for this reason, and try and future-proof them as much as possible. If you go and look at the literature from these companies, all of these companies have different buzzwords, and it's not just a buzzword. It's proprietary technology developed and researched the crap out of to come up with the thing that provides the least amount of masking or hiding of things as possible. And all these companies are working so hard to give you an objective sense of what is coming out of the music going into the air and then into your ears. And that is what you're getting. You're getting hardwood floors when you buy nice speakers like this. So hopefully that kind of declouds, or not demystifies, but just takes away some of the fog from this issue of like, can I get away with budget speakers or whatever? I know that you guys probably wanted more clarity from me on like, which one should I buy? What should the price point be? How can, you know, can I get good stuff for under $1,000 or $500? And there's probably a lot of you guys going like, we can't afford this. And I totally understand that. But sometimes you get what you pay for, and consider, I know this sounds kind of snobby and I'm really not trying to be snobby, but consider the investments you make in your music and in yourself to be just that. It's an investment that's going to pay back because you put the work in now to get great stuff, to be able to make objective decisions about your output. You are investing in yourself when you're doing this stuff. There's some things you can kind of skip on. Maybe a microphone doesn't have to be so fancy. Maybe the broadcast arm can kind of fall apart. It's from IKEA, whatever. Maybe you just need a little audio interface. But when it comes to your room and your speakers and your computer and other things like that, we make certain decisions about what we value over other stuff. And hopefully I've laid out a case and a metaphor for why I think that you should go the extra mile and put out a little bit more coin to get something back that I think will, you know, help your art go even further and represent you even better. I say that a lot on this channel. It's about making sure that you're giving yourself the best chance at great representation with this gear, with this technology. And high-end speakers, the likes of the Focals and the Atoms and the PMCs, I'm trying to think of other brands here. I could go on and on. Neumann, Dyne Audio, whatever. That's what those guys provide. So I'm kind of repeating myself now. But anyway, I'm going to leave some end cards to a video that I did ages ago about, you know, when you're buying your first pair of monitors, what to know about, and also the PMC one. What do you guys think about this? Am I off base? I really want you guys to leave comments. I love the discussion that we can generate on this channel and be like respectful and polite and everything. I'm happy to answer more questions. Just leave them in the comments. Hit me on Twitter, Gmail, whatever. Yeah. Thanks for watching. Take care.